Hey everybody, thank you for joining me. It's Jang here from JANGBRiCKS.com with a look at a LEGO movie set. This is Metalbeard's Sea Cow, and it comes with 2,741 pieces. The ship is no joke. It's fully 2 feet tall, and almost that long too. Most of the over 2,700 pieces in the set go into the ship, so that means it takes hours to build this thing up. For better or for worse though, it really doesn't use any fancy building techniques. The assembly is all really straightforward, there's just a lot of it. Working from front to back, you've got a long bow sprit and jib boom with a set of small little foresails there. No rigging actually attaching up to the forward mast though. And there you've got the sea cow itself. Some old ships used mermaids as their sort of mascots, but Metalbeard uses a cow with wings. You'll see a whole lot of these pearl, metallic gold details all the way around the entire ship. Lots of small things, lots of round elements. It's just kind of a repeating theme. And then here we get to the forward mast. You've got three masts all together, and this one has a little bit of a weapon system here. This is actually a quad barrel turret, and you can turn these barrels up and down. Not properly a turret though, I guess, because it doesn't rotate around. You can only go up and down, so it can only shoot in line with the direction the boat is going. And that is a spot right there where you can put a minifig in to control this. Next, you have your sails, which are made out of Technic panels. A little bit of chain rigging there, and that goes all the way up to the top where you have a crow's nest or a little observation post. Going back down to the deck here, you'll see that if you saw the LEGO movie, you know that the Sea Cow is not purely a sailing ship. It is also powered. It has an engine or a set of engines, and it actually has kind of a steam engine set up here with a boiler room down in there. It's a little hard to see, but that's actually the furnace room. There's a little bit of fire inside of there, so that's where you would shovel coal in. And this box right here actually has the coal in it, and you can see the shovel right there for shoveling into it. And then over here is your boiler setup. So you've got some stacks for turning water into steam. I'm sure that this is a steam powered boat. And you'll see various propellers and things that are powered all the way around it. Most obvious here on the sides are these paddles. Not quite large enough, it looks like, to really go down to the water line here, but maybe it's supposed to be spinning up some air and somehow or another providing some thrust. And one of the major features here is this huge smokestack. It's just thick and tall. Probably blocks some of the air around this thing, but it looks cool. Also over here on the other side, you've got a different box that doesn't have a top on it, and this just has some weapons or some tools actually in it. That you can use for working on this thing. You've got a hammer and a large wrench and also a crowbar in gold. So that's nice to get that in a pearly gold color. Now on both sides of the ship, you have anchors and they just stick out with small little bits of chain. And that looks like it's just for looks, but it's actually able to retract and deploy the anchors. And they did a really cool thing here with the boiler unit that works on a winch. So this is actually connected here. You can see it's just a little hidden feature, and it goes around and just allows you to drop your anchor down. And then when you want to bring it up, you can just keep turning it because it works either way. Basically, you just turn it in one direction, it's gonna drop, let all that slack out, and then it's gonna turn around and wind it up the other way. So you've got these going down and up on both sides. Down below on the lower deck, you've got three cannons in here, and I'll show you those a little bit more once we get to the interior of the boat. But these are ones that can actually shoot, so you can put little 1x1 cylinder pieces in here and shoot those out. You've got three on either side. Another nice thing that's used for detail around the whole thing is these Technic sleeves that accept Technic pins, and they are provided in metallic silver, so you've got a whole lot of those. Good parts to have for custom builders. Up above, you've got the main mast back there with all of the main sails, and that goes way, 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 way up. That's where you get the major height of the entire set. You can just see so many sails, and then all the way up at the top, one more crow's nest and a little wind vane up there. Here's a look at it from the other side and from the back, and that allows you to see the pieces used for creating the mast, and you can also see the rigging along the side that you can actually climb up, and that takes us back down to the deck. Now, you've got a major room in here. that you actually build up with some detail, but you can see that, I mean, you can't really get in there from the front, the main opening. You know, you've got a nice little section here above with some stickers on there. Again, hard to see. Everything there is hard to see. The access is actually from the sides. They use these plate height hinges, one above, one below, and all of this is going to open up. Now you notice you've got these nice grated window pieces here, and also down below you've got some traditional 2x2 windows, but they put stickers on them to put a little bit of grating detail on those as well. This opens up very easily. Still kind of tough to see, but you've got your weapon storage back here. So you've got a barrel with rifles or muskets and a couple of swords, and you've also got a couple of pistols on the other side. And there's kind of a nice basic chandelier up above. The thing that really detracts from the look inside of here is the use of these Technic lift arms, which are really important for the structure. It's even tougher to see the backside of this room, but this is your engine control room where you've got valves for controlling the flow of steam to the different steam-powered propellers and other active propulsion systems of the ship. Next up, we get to the second highest level, and this is the captain's cabin. Now you can see that that has a door with a key required to get in, but they do have key storage on the outside, so not very secure there. But the good news for this one is that finally we get access to the inside. This whole top piece, this whole assembly just comes right off. Here you've got some navigational equipment, including a globe, which can be spun around. You've got a sextant right there, and over there's a map down on the ground. I'll show you more of the stickered tiles, but over here, this looks like it's either a sink or a tap for dispensing some kind of drink, like a good pirate's ale or mead. On the other side, a couple of quills and an inkwell, more storage for paper pieces. You've got a ship in a bottle piece right here. It's actually a printed bottle. A couple more just regular bottles on the side. And in the middle here on the floor, you've got a treasure chest, and you can fill that up with some simulated gems and gold coins. Here's a look at the tiles as promised. You've got a couple of treasure map pieces there, and then a couple of blueprints. Looks like a signed blueprint set for the entire ship, and then one for just the turbine paddle unit that's used on the side. And then you've got this nice large picture of what Metalbeard used to look like when he was a minifig. The next level up top on the outside is the helm, and this is the one area out of everything on the Sea Cow where Metalbeard himself can actually stand. Everything else is too small for him to fit in, but minifigures fit everywhere else. And then back here he also has a nice little telescope kind of set up on the back. You can adjust the angle on that. And lastly, you have the aftmost mast, which just has this funny little assembly of sails up at the very top. Looking down the back or stern of the ship, you can see that you've got one propeller set used right here, and you can spin that up if you want. Then you've got the Sea Cow name on the back here with some decorations, including a representation of the captain. Then you have another propeller here, which you can spin, and that's a little bit more of a built-up thing. And yet another small little propeller down here. Got some chains coming down the sides, got the little wings of the Sea Cow and its wings. Nice little rows of lights or torches on the sides here, but that's just a little thing that spins. And then down here you've got yet another propeller, so that one's able to spin around. And you also have a nice rudder that you can actually turn back and forth. Earlier I mentioned that we could get inside of the boat to look at the cannons, and that's actually a very simple process because all of this main center mast structure with the furnace and boiler and everything, all that center bit comes out as one assembly, and it's not even attached with any studs, it's just sitting in there. Now when you pull this up, you get to see some little secret areas down in here, just areas that aren't frequently seen, and you've got, looks like a little bit of treasure that's fallen through the deck, and there's a rat right there, and on the other side, look at that. More lost treasure that's just been sitting around forever, probably. Simulated gold coins, a couple of gems, a gauntlet, and a skull. Now from the top we can see all the way down to the gun deck, and there's where you can see those little cannons. You've got a nice little torch here for lighting them. This is all ammunition. Ammunition store over here is those 1x1 cylinder pieces. The mechanism of the winch over here that's That's your anchor winch. If you kind of sneak around and look just out towards the rear of the ship, you can see a little bit more of the boiler section, or possibly part of one of the engines for turning one or more of the propellers. Also, if you look up from there, it gives you just a little bit better view into that main first deck with the kind of control room. The set includes a pair of micromanagers, one kind of medium-sized one and one relatively small one. Looking at this one first, you've got the larger claws, and these can be fully articulated in all kinds of different ways. This one also has a so-called satellite dish on it, which rotates down from the back and will face forward and is used for tracking purposes. And this one will open up on the sides to give you access to flick-fire missiles. So you've got one right there, and you also have storage for extra ammo, one on either side. The little guy has relatively little articulation, can't really rotate these, but you can just kind of move them in and out. You can also change the angles of the hands around for holding things. But its big deal is the capturing net that's just kind of stuffed in there. And they've got this little push pin on the back, which you use to send that net out. So you're trying to go after a minifig and then you shoot this out. It's really not elegant at all. It's supposed to just come out, and that's supposed to wrap around something. So you kind of have to imagine it and do it yourself, but that's it. For figures, I'll start with the proper minifigures in the set, and that starts with Emmett and Wildstyle and Vitruvius, who are all the existing same ones that we've already had in previous sets from Wave 1. And then we finally get Benny. This is the first set that has included an official Benny figure, and we'll be seeing more of him in Wave 2. I'll also be doing a separate video just about him, because he really is special and there's a lot of history behind that figure and what goes into it. I'm also gonna let you see what these guys look like without all their extra stuff attached. Here's a look at them from the back. I still really, really love Vitruvius's cape. That's just awesome. Here's how they all look stripped down from the back, so you can see the full torso prints on the backs of these two. And here's how they look with everything on from the fronts with their secondary faces. This is Queasy Kitty, the Unikitty, this time with a bad case of seasickness. So exclusive here, using sand green pieces, including a sand green unicorn horn, different color tail, different color everything, all the way around. And there's a look at her from the other side. The set includes Emmett's double-decker sofa here, including the ladders on the sides. These have some tiles on them and also some studs, so you're able to actually put your figures onto there. It doesn't look so great from the back, but this is pretty appropriate and accurate to the movie. And there's one configuration that just barely allows all of them to sit or stand on here. All three of these figures really don't sit very well because of the stuff on their backs. They don't really have enough room. Really could have used just a little bit extra room here, but you are able to get them all on there. It's just a tight squeeze. Last up is a mini version of Metalbeard. Not mini fig, but miniature. This is not the same metal beard that we got before. You can see there's quite a difference in size and complexity between the original version and the one included with the sea cow, but I'll cover all that better in a separate video that just compares those two. But this is a worthy miniature version. This is well done. It uses the new style of small ball joint connection pieces to good effect to create a small little steampunk kind of style of mech. They got all of his details captured here in smaller scale, all the important things. He's got the chest. Unfortunately, he did not have his organs in this one, but does have the chest, has his large sword, which is a separate thing you can take out. Got the little articulated fingers actually there. And you've got even the shark on the side. It's just brick built this time. Plenty of articulation, so he's able to move his arms up. Everything looks pretty good here. He's got his peg leg. He's got the anchor hanging down on one side. These represent the dual cannons, the smokestack for his power system. And even though it's using the exact same beard and the same head and hat and everything, it doesn't really look like it's out of proportion here. So I'm pretty happy with that. So all the important stuff is still included here. It's just in a smaller size than we got before. This is a real statement set. If you get this and you build it, this says, I love Lego, or at least I really love the Lego movie. It's definitely better for display than for play. It has a lot of small details on it, a lot of just features really packed closely together, so there's not a whole lot of room to move your characters around. It's so tall that it's not going to fit onto most shelves unless you have a shelving unit that's fairly short, and then you can put it on top, so it's really not good for storage, and I personally don't recommend it for younger LEGO players, but this is definitely better for the older crowd. Folks are gonna more appreciate how it looks than what it can do. For what it is, I personally am more than satisfied with the way that this whole thing worked out. It looks great, goes together well, and comes with a good set of figures. So those are my thoughts. What are your thoughts? Please feel free to share your thoughts in the comment section, what you think about the set, if you like it, if you don't like it, if you have specific thoughts about certain aspects of it, you know, if you want to go into detail, or if you just want to leave a couple words about it. It's always good to hear more different people's thoughts. For now, that's it for me. Thank you for watching, and please stay tuned for more videos to come. I've also done lots of other review videos in the past, including ones on other LEGO movie sets. You can browse and search for anything on my channel, and you can stay on top of all of my latest updates on the blog at jangbrickss.com. Hope to see you there, and I'll be talking to you again soon.